As Francis Coppola was becoming the most sought-after director in the world, another filmmaker, similarly steeped in the ethos of personal filmmaking, made his way to San Francisco.
I really originally wanted to be a writer, a novelist, and I'd gone to Harvard Law School, didn't like that. Was a graduate student going for my master's at the University of Chicago, didn't like that. So my wife Rose and I hopped in a car, and we sort of thought about going back to Cambridge, Massachusetts. But it was almost as if we came to Route 66, and instead of taking a left turn, we turned right and drove across the country.
I think of Philip as sort of the resident intellectual. He hasn't done that many pictures, but each one is very, very special.
In a series of vivid, unconventional films, Philip Kaufman has shown an iconoclast's love of subverting expectation. No film better represents this than The Right Stuff.
Somebody had sent me Tom Wolfe's book. This kind of rambling, rambunctious, high-energy journalism that had an ironic, you know, sense that overlay the seriousness of the theme.
As with most of his films, Kaufman made The Right Stuff primarily in the Bay Area. Rather than go to Hollywood for the film's special effects, he established his own low-tech unit in an abandoned cannery south of Market Street.
You look at that movie and it's hard to tell that it wasn't real, that there wasn't a camera there when the plane was spinning out of control, but there wasn't. It was done on 3rd Street in San Francisco, you know, on the roof of a building.
For the film's more ethereal effects, Kaufman turned to San Francisco experimental filmmaker Jordan Belson.
Jordan Belson is an experimental filmmaker who creates these incredible sort of visual kaleidoscopic images. Phil brought him in, and he was a guy who's very independent and does his own films, and we don't even know how he does it. I mean, he had his own sort of secret methods to create those images that were really incredible in the film.
In another filmmaker's hands, The Right Stuff might have been a flag-draped slice of Americana. Kaufman brought to the film something rare in American cinema, a sense of mysticism.
It's sort of a crazy idea, but it's the idea that when John Glenn was flying in outer space, there were suddenly all these sparks. So we use the sparks from the fire that the Aborigines built as if they were reaching into outer space and becoming part of John Glenn's experience.
That are brilliantly lit up like they're luminescent. I never saw anything like it. You don't think these things could be alive, do you?
Every story needs some mystery to it, because I think that's what we all respond to.
In 1987, Kaufman teamed with another San Francisco filmmaker to make The Unbearable Lightness of Being.
I was having dinner with Saul Zantz once, and I remember we started talking about it, and I was saying, you know, I love the book. You know, we all thought it was, you could never make a movie of that.
Kaufman and Zantz turned The Unbearable Lightness of Being into a rich exploration of politics and eroticism set against the backdrop of the Russian invasion of Czechoslovakia.
The hat. Comes from my grandfather's grandfather. He lived a long, long time ago.
Many of Kaufman's films feature a frank presentation of sexuality. It is a risk he has consistently been willing to take.
What are you looking at?
Your eyes. I'm interested in eroticism, sexuality, and I feel it's something that, you know, in Hollywood, you know, tries to deal with those things and sometimes does, but it just, you know, sometimes they, you know, it becomes sort of a side thing on the way to murder or something like that. And I just feel that if these things are handled boldly, that you can have very successful films that way.
Though he often works for Hollywood studios, Kaufman holds fast to his independent roots and to the neighborhood that continues to feed his creativity.
Even though film is my life, I still don't want to be obsessed with the business end of films. I mean, we're sitting in this office now, and there's a coffee shop right underneath. There's three or four along the street here. There's a park on the corner. All the people who work with us on editing this film, you know, we will walk, take long walks at lunchtime over Koi Tower and eat on the waterfront. And in the studio, it's quite the opposite thing. I often say I don't know why there's so much bad feeling in Hollywood. I mean, I know there's a lot at stake and so forth, but we almost wish a little magic dust could be sprinkled there and people would say, you know, we can be tough, we can be hold to our opinions, but we can also create a good spirit in making films.